Good morning. Oh, we can do better than that. Good morning. That sounds much better. For those who may not be knowledgeable, I am Tyra Crawford, senior communications media major from Sacramento, California, and I serve as the executive president of the Student Government Association. And it is with such great pleasure to greet you all. On the behalf of the Student Government Association, our 66 Miss Alabama Agricultural and Mechanical University, and the entire student body, welcome to our Kickoff inaugural Black History Month event. It is my hope that everyone reflects on the words of our speaker and furthermore reflects on all of the contributing efforts from every pioneer throughout African American history. So again, welcome, welcome, and welcome. Thank you.
Well, good morning. I get the blessing to come on and bring greetings from the greatest city just this side of heaven. It's called Huntsville. My name is Devin Keith, and I am the District 1 representative, the district that we sit in, this great college. And I just want to say one thing, and I'll take my seat. As I sat here and thought and looked around the room, I want to share a story, a very prominent story, one I heard when I got a chance to go to grad school. In the late 1800s, the Jim Crow South had started to muster. And individuals were seeking opportunities at the Reconstructive period. A professor from Boston University travels for the first time past the Mason-Dixon. He is headed to a university called Fisk. The professor is given travel money to go on two legs, one down to South Carolina, and then from that next point from South Carolina over to Fisk. As he travels on an integrated bus, he thinks nothing of it, and he gets to his bus stop in the Carolinas. He gets out, goes into the waiting area, and then he sees where it diverges. There's a segregated side, one that says colored, one that says white. He walks into the colored to see a room filled with young African Americans. There's about five men, he says, in this room. The individuals are sitting there waiting on the bus to come. The integrated bus route changes and comes at a slower pace, so they were told they would be waiting for a couple of hours. Among that time, they start having a conversation. The professor notices this, and the individuals stand up and go to the corner. One of the individuals faces the corner, and the other individuals act as a barrier. This individual was trying to use the restroom. So the professor, one born in Boston, jumps up and says, hold on. Why don't you use the restroom? Don't do this out in public. They all look astonished, as if the professor did not know what was going on. See, in the Jim Crow South, there was a split, as we all know, in bathrooms. So he said, we cannot pay the tax. See, they used to put taxes on the doors in public restrooms, and you'd have to put a 1 cent into the door to open up the lock. They did not have enough money at the time to open that lock for all. But the professor said something that was very prominent and profound, and I think it's very unique to a moment like this as we open up this month. He said, wait just a moment. He reaches into his bag and pulls out the nickel needed to open that door. And he goes on to say, after I pay for the first person to go in, the next person, all he needs to do is hold the door and everyone can use the restroom. That is Black history. Generations and generations before us have opened a door that wanted to be shut. And they are leading the charge to tell us all we need to do is hold that door open. So I think it's very important. If I was to grab the motto of the United States in 1783, it says, E pluribus unum, out of many, one. Take the joy and the pride there is the generations that have come before us, and let us continue to hold the door for everybody behind us. Thank you.
Let it be sound, loud as the wind. Can we give our beautiful university choir another round of applause? That was an awesome job. Good afternoon. I am Julian Griffith Battle, a junior accounting major from the Rocket City, Huntsville, Alabama, and I serve as the executive secretary for the Student Government Association. Dr. Terrell Strayhorn is professor and director of the Center for Higher Education Enterprise at The Ohio State University. A renowned student success scholar, highly acclaimed public speaker, and award-winning writer, Strayhorn is author of 10 books, over 60 book chapters, and more than 150 journal articles and conference papers, and many other scholarly publications. He has presented over 300 keynotes and invited lectures across the globe. Dr. Strayhorn maintains an active and highly visible research agenda focusing on major policy issues in education, such as student access and achievement, issues of race, equity, and diversity, impact of college on students, and student learning and development. His book, College Students' Sense of Belonging, A Key to Educational Success, has won a book award and sold record copies nationally. Strayhorn received a bachelor's degree from the University of Virginia, a master's degree in educational policy from the Curry School of Education at the University of Virginia, and doctorate in higher education from Virginia Tech. He is a member of Alpha Phi Alpha Fraternity Incorporated and a native of Virginia Beach, Virginia. Known for using the hashtag DoGoodWork on social media, Strayhorn was named one of the country's top diversity scholars by Diverse Issues in Higher Education in 2011, one of Business First's top 40 under 40, and one of top 20 to know in education, and became the youngest full professor in Hawaii State's history. Prior to Ohio State, Strayhorn was special assistant to the provost at the University of Tennessee, Knoxville, and research associate at the Council of Graduate Schools in Washington, D.C. Alabama A&M University, I introduce to you Dr. Terrell Strayhorn.
So please, a wonderful round of applause to Julian for that great introduction. And there's so much going on right now that I am excited to have the opportunity to speak after such a great way to open the day. So here's what I want to do. I'm Terrell Strayhorn, professor and director of the Center for Higher Education Enterprise at The Ohio State University. A lot of lights flashing at me. At The Ohio State University, and I've been there at Ohio State University for about 7 years. Before then, I was on the faculty at the University of Tennessee, Knoxville for 5 years. If you put it all together, there's about 13 years that I've been a professor. It's the longest job I've ever held in my entire life. It's a job that I love holding and one that I'm very proud of. And so here's what I want to do, because there are about four things that I think I want to accomplish in the time that I have remaining with you this afternoon. There are some points I want to make about Black history, about our past, and about our future. And I want to do it in a way that will come across clearly, it will motivate, it will inspire, but I also want to do it in a way that connects with what's already happened. If I really wanted to connect with what's already happened. I would have, once Julian finished my introduction, I would have come up here to the platform and I would have started singing, "When I see Jesus, amen. When I see Jesus, amen." But I'm not going to do that yet because I learned in church, you don't ever jump into a moving plane. You got to set your own plane and get it moving down the road. And then when we take off, I promise you, if you want to sing, I'll take you there. But we got to go a few more places before we go there first. So a couple of points I want to make about Black history's past and present. But I do want to thank those who sang. So a round of applause to all of those who sang, Mr. Courtney Moore. But before I get too far down the road into what I want to say, I do want to say a special thanks again to everyone here at Alabama A&M University. It's my first time in Huntsville, first time at Alabama A&M, and if you work with me in this talk, it may not be my last time, be my first time, but it won't be my last time. But I do want to say special thanks to Dr. Gilmore, who's been my colleague and friend and who met me at a conference in Florida and made sure that I got from the hotel to campus this morning safely. Round of applause for your very own Dr. Gilmore. And I understand that Ms. Boone and Dr. Crosby and a number of other folks, everyone who had anything to do with planning the Kickoff Black History Month celebration, will you stand? Anybody who's on a planning committee, anybody who had anything to do with planning today, stand, stand. Things don't happen. Yeah, stand, stand, stand. Give them a round of applause for putting together this wonderful celebration. And then I would be remiss if I did not celebrate and recognize you can probably tell, and if you can't tell yet, you'll be able to tell by the end, that not only am I a professor, not only am I my mom's and dad's son and my grandmother's grandson, and evenly, interestingly enough, my kid's dad, but it turns out that I'm also out of the church. And so when you come out of the church, you know that you don't step into somebody else's church or somebody else's house without recognizing the shepherd of that house. So I'm here at Alabama A&M, and I'm grateful to everyone who's worked with my team to get me here. But I do want to celebrate your president, Dr. Eugene. Come on, round of applause for Dr. and Lady Eugene. Let's thank and appreciate the leadership of Alabama A&M President and First Lady. All right, so we've got to go down the road and I've got to get some things covered that I want to say. So here's how I want to talk with you today. Where are all my first year students, first year freshman students? Come on, round of applause for all the first year students. First year students, make some noise. Okay, where are my second year sophomore students? Where are y'all at? All right, come on, sophomores in the house, make some noise. Yeah, clap for the sophomores, clap it up for the sophomores. All right, and then third year, juniors, 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 juniors. It gets louder and louder, and who everybody came to see today and everybody's waiting for. And at the end of this semester, we get to celebrate you. Where are our graduating seniors? Come on, graduating class of 2017. Make some noise for the class of 2017. So just like you just shouted for yourselves, as I'm talking about our history, if I say something that connects with you, something that you think other people in the room who are falling asleep should pay attention to, make some noise. If I'm saying something that, you know, you've been dying for a speaker to say, then don't let me say it by myself. Make some noise. Holler back at your boy. If I say something that's profound, you hadn't really thought about it that way, and you're glad that I did say it, then make some noise. If you make enough noise, in about a few minutes, I'm going to take my seat, and we will be done with my speech. But I want to make sure that before I leave, I say a couple of points about Black history, and that ultimately our purpose, our assignment for today, is that we will not forget the past as we move into the future. Remember, the goal is not to dwell on the past. We must recognize the past. We must study the past. We must appreciate our past. But we cannot dwell on those things that used to be, because our assignment is to go into the future, is to be in the present and get ready, prepare ourselves for our future. And to get us there, there are a couple things I want to say. So if you're on social media, I'm on social media. I ask you to connect with me on social media. Follow me on social media. I actually use social media a lot. So it's not like if you follow me, you'll never hear from me again or you won't see anything. If you follow me, I'll follow you back. If I don't follow you back, next time I come back, call me out about it. Say, you know what? You told me you're going to follow me back and you didn't do it. But I'm TL Strayhorn on all things social media. That's IG and Snapchat and everything else. And then the Center for Higher Education Enterprise is also on social media, CHEE _OSU. And in fact, we've already posted some things on social media already today. And if you want to follow me on Facebook, I go by my real name on Facebook. The problem is when you travel the country a lot and everybody friends you, you get maxed out for friends. So if you follow me on Facebook and I don't friend you back, it's not because I don't want to be your friend. I'll friend you on everything else. It's because I don't have any space for more friends on Facebook. But I have a public page, TL Terrell L Strayhorn. If you use Lamont, which is my middle name, it's Black History Month, I can say that publicly. Lamont is my middle name. I have a real serious Black History Month name, don't I? Terrell Lamont Strayhorn. But if you go Terrell L, just use my middle initial, that's a public page and you can friend me or follow me there. All right, so I see all those coming in, that's great. And we can connect and talk about later. Anything I say that's real smart, tweet it, twerk it, whatever you want to do with it, but share it with the world. Anything I say that's not smart, don't put it on social media so that people can call me out about that stuff. Let's set a bit of the context for why we're here today and what we want to talk about. And I think that how many of you in here have ever read the book by the writer Charles Dickens, who wrote in the book A Tale of Two Cities? It opens with a very famous line that we're living in the best of times. We're living in the worst of times. Who's read that book or read those lines, right? So I thought that was a great way to start my talk today, building on what Mr. Moore and the choir have already said. We are actually right now in 2017 living, especially when it comes to Black history, in what I would call the best of times and the worst of times. Why the best of times? The best of times because in this time, this age, this era, the past couple of decades, African Americans have experienced great success. That is, there are more African Americans now living in middle income and upper income families than ever before in our nation's history. We have more African Americans who can, as social scientists and historians of the past used to say, we have more African Americans who can grab hold of the American dream than ever before. American dream, life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. That more African Americans own homes, own cars, have their own businesses. There are more African Americans who are CEOs of Fortune 500, Fortune 1000 companies in the United States than ever before. Best of times. Why the best of times? Because interestingly enough, although there are some concerns here, there are more African Americans in education than there were back in the 50s and 60s. And a reason, that's so proud to make that statement here at Alabama A&M University on, clap it up for Alabama A&M, because it used to be the case. I just told my class, I teach at Ohio State, and on Monday I was in the class, and we were talking about President Trump. We're gonna come to him, don't worry about it, we're gonna hit that too. So we were talking about President Trump, and my student said to me, Dr. Strayhorn, do you think we really need affirmative action? Do you think we still need race conscious policies in higher education? After all, it's the best of times. We've just witnessed and experienced 8 years with a Black man in the White House. Let's clap it up for President Obama and Lady Obama. 8 years, 2 terms. I remember back in 2008 when President Obama was elected. I was at home, and I remember when the news broke, I stayed up all night. I dared my eyes to close because I wanted to see, was he going to actually win? And I have to confess to you, because it's part of where we got to go. At that time in 2008, I did not expect him to win. Not because he wasn't bright enough, not because he wasn't capable, not because he wasn't the best candidate, but because I didn't believe in the country enough to make it happen. I didn't believe in democracy enough to make it happen. And although I was hopeful, I sat there that night and I said, eyes, I dare you to close because I got to see what happens here. And then the news broke that he won. I thought, well, that's got to be a typo. So I'm going to sit here. I'm going to check all the news. I'm not going to trust one news station. All of them are going to have to converge on this message before I will accept that President Obama was elected. And then as I started seeing multiple channels say it, I didn't cry on ET. I don't cry when little babies fall off the bed. But for some reason that night in my bed, I just broke into tears because I was excited about what this meant. Best of times, because we've witnessed an African-American, a black male, to ascend to the highest position in the country. Best of times. Even at a time when we have more African-Americans in education, there was once a time, so I told my students on Monday, I said, I absolutely believe we need race-conscious policies. I still think we need affirmative action because I want my students who are equally as diverse as the students in this room. I told my students at Ohio State on Monday, I said, you have to understand that about 30, 40, 50 years ago, I would not have been able to be your professor. They said, well, why are people protesting? Why are all these women protesting President Trump? I don't think President Trump cares about their protests. I don't think their protests are working with President Trump. I don't think people want to see them protest. And I told them again, I said, well, you got to stop for a second because I'm your professor. And you all like me and I like you. You love me, I love you. And we're going to have a good class today. But remember, it was people protesting. Back in the 50s, back in the 60s, in the face of people who didn't want to see it, who didn't want to hear it, that opened up the doors, is because of their stubborn resistance to the way things were that things started to change. That in fact, we live in the best of times, but we cannot sit there and celebrate only that President Obama got to the White House or that only now African Americans are both at historically black colleges and predominantly white institutions. There are 21 million college students in this country. 2 million of them are African American. We have more black women than black men, black women than black men, more black women in higher education than black men, more black women. Yeah, clap it up for the sisters. And there are problems associated with that. That's why we got to increase access and success for more men of color to higher education. I see a lot of sisters saying yes. So for all my heterosexual sisters who are looking for educated brothers, you can't fight over that one brother who's in college. And despite all of our advancement in society, what we know from social science, where are my sociology majors? Anybody a sociology major? So sociology majors, back me up here. Sociologists know this, that despite all of the increases in diversity over time, the one thing that has remained true in this country is that we still generally marry within our race. Interestingly enough, regardless of sexual orientation, people still marry within their race. So it means that when you go to college and you are a black female going to college, you are significantly more likely to look for a black brother who's educated. If you are a black heterosexual black brother who goes to college, it is significantly more likely that you are going to look for a black sister to marry. Which means that for most heterosexual black men in college, there are at least 2 to 3, if you're good looking, 2 to 3 women you can pick from for most dances and events and parties. But for the sisters who are heterosexual, it means that there's increased competition for that one brother. That's why they unfriend each other so much on Facebook, and that's why they unfollow each other daily. It's because there are social consequences associated with this inequity. Best of times and the worst of times. Best of times because we have still today, I believe, I hope you believe, one of the strongest countries in all of the world. One of the strongest countries. There are privileges that we enjoy here in the United States that other countries could only dream about. And no matter what's happening in the White House, we've got to remember that there's more power in this room right now than the White House has ever witnessed. There's more power in this room right now than the White House has ever witnessed. It's only when we dare to believe in ourselves. So how does that connect to where I want to go? First of all, you're here at Alabama A&M. I'm a man of faith. I'm a firm believer that all things happen for a reason. I'll give you several examples of that along the way here today. But there's a reason why you are at Alabama A&M University right now. You could have gone to, there are 4,300 colleges and universities in this country. And you chose one of those 4,000. There were 4,299 other schools you could have attended. So why in the world are, ask somebody, look at your neighbor and say, why are you here? why are you here at Alabama A&M University? Why are you here in the year 2017? Why are you friends with the person that you're friends with? Why are you rooming with the people that you're rooming with? Why are you hanging out with the people that you're hanging? There's a reason why you met each other. My best example of this is Uber. How many of you in here know what Uber is or ever took Uber in your life? So Uber has an interesting story. Uber is a group of friends who decided to go out on a Friday night to dinner. After dinner, one of the friends said, I don't want the night to end. We should go catch a movie. The other friend said, well, a movie? What time is the movie that we want to see? So he looked up on his phone, pulled out his phone, looked up a movie and said, oh my gosh, the movie starts at 7:30. And they started thinking they didn't have enough time to call the cab, the taxi, get to the movie theater and get in before they would start missing the movie. And one of the friends turned to the other friend and said, oh, we got to call a cab. You know, wouldn't it be great if we could just take out our phones and just call up a driver? I don't know, like a mobile app where you could just call up somebody and say, hey, we're trying to get to the movie, it's four of us, and you could jump into the car. The other friend said, who in the world would the driver be? He said, anybody who had a car and wanted to make money could just like turn it on. I don't know, like turn it on and just come pick us up. And the other friend turned and said, you mean to tell me you think people would get in the car with a perfectly good stranger and go somewhere? No one's gonna get in the car with a stranger. It turns out anybody will get in the car with a stranger in this country. And so before you know it, they call the cab, they get to the movie, they decide to go to another movie that night. When the movie's over, they go home. One of the friends, not the friend who said, tell me more about who the driver is, or the friend who said nobody will get in the car. The other friend who had not spoken yet called up the friend who dreamed the idea and said, hey, remember that thing you said about the mobile app? It's not a bad idea. I thought those other two were picking on you too much. I mean, it could work, but like, we need someone who knows something about mobile apps. Do you know anything about mobile apps? He said, well, I was in college with a guy who was always into technology. Let me hit him up and see what he's doing nowadays, and said, hey, friend from college, do you know anything about mobile apps? He said, yeah, I know how to develop apps. He said, well, here's my idea. He shared his idea. His job, his assignment was to have the idea. Sometimes you've got to remember your job is not to develop the app. Your job is not to figure out the plan. Your job is to simply dream the idea. Then you turn to your network of friends and say, look, I got this idea. And they say, well, how in the world? And who say, I don't know all those answers. My job is to have the dream or the idea. But you know what? If you can help me figure out how to put it into action, before you know it, we have a team. So the friend called the mobile app developer. Before you know it, they're starting to build the mobile app president. And then he says, wait a second. If you're going to pay the people, you need e-commerce. Do you know anything about e-commerce? He said, no. But then one of the friends said, well, I have a friend who knows a friend who's in business. Before you know it, they call up that friend. And before you know it, they have all the parts. And guess what? Because of one friend's will and courage to dream on a sidewalk on a Friday night, Uber's in 70 countries today. That's what happens when you answer the question, why am I here and why do I know you? Why are we friends? We're not friends just to talk about how good your hair looks, and your hair does look great. We're not here to be friends just for you to talk about my intentionally mismatched socks. It's not here for you to talk about, that's fun, it's good, it's game, but there's a reason why we got to know each other. And it has more to do with our future than our present or our past. You meet people because they're here to help you get to your future. So the best thing I think is to ask your friends, well, on a good day, not today, but on a good day, you know, after Black History Month or during Black History Month, turn to your friends and ask them, what are you doing today to help me get to my future? Now, a good friend doesn't just ask that question. A good friend reciprocates and says, and by the way, here's what I'm going to start doing to help you get to your future. There's a reason why you came to Alabama A&M University all together. There's a reason why those of you who are graduating the class of 2017, there's a reason why you're in the same class. You got to figure out what is it and how do we each benefit? How does the institution benefit from us all being together? Because we've gained access to higher education, but I didn't come to get the t-shirt. I didn't come to get the sweatshirt. I don't want the Alabama A&M coffee mug. Actually, I do want a coffee mug, but that's a different point for a different day. But I don't want just the coffee mug. We get access to higher education to be successful, because access without success is useless. So much of what I do as a social scientist is I study college students. And there are a couple things I came to tell you about my research. that it relates to what we want to talk about for Black History Month, I first of all came to tell each and every one of you, those who need to hear it, you matter. You matter. You matter. You matter individually, you matter collectively. We all matter. And that no matter what the message is on the news or the message is on social media, quite frankly, these are my politics. They don't have to be your politics, but since I'm speaking and the day you speak, I promise you, you can say what you want too. No matter who's in the White House, we all matter. And we have to understand that part of what we have to do during Black History Month is celebrate the things that matter. You matter. I matter. We matter. Alabama A&M matters. Historically, Black colleges matter. And I put on social media the other day, about 2 days after the transfer of power, if you go to the White House website or if you go to my social media, my Twitter page, 2 days after the transfer of power, I went to the White House website, the new White House website, and I searched for the word HBCUs. And there was not a single hit on the White House page. But the archived page, which is President Obama's White House, when you type in HBCUs, there are over 4,000 hits. So I decided to create a picture and then put it on social media and tag President Trump and the White House and all of those people in his cabinet and said, HBCUs are important. HBCUs, there are 105 in this country that educate over 300,000 students collectively. They still produce the top number, they're the top producers of Black scientists and Black doctors and Black lawyers. And so they deserve a space on the White House website. So I said, go ahead and put it back up there. I'll wait. And then the very next day, I did the same thing and typed in African American. When you type in African American, the day I typed it in on the White House website, there are only 5 hits to the word African American. 4 of them refer to President Obama and Lady Obama. But when you go to their website and type in African American, it's just a long list of references to all of the contributions of African Americans. We have to watch in the transfer of power what happens to our past, because our present and our future depends on it. We gotta be vocal and speak out about this because we matter. Black lives matter. Black lives matter. And although the Black Lives Matter movement is a little dated and old now, Black lives still matter. I remember when I first bought my first Black Lives Matter t-shirt. I thought about wearing it today, but I decided I'd wear something different. I bought this Black Lives Matter t-shirt. I bought it, it looked great on the internet, even better when you, you know, put it in your cart and you pay for it. And then I waited for it to arrive, and then it came to where I sent it to, and before you know it, I went to my P.O. box and I opened my package, First Lady, and I got my Black Lives Matter. It was the fun size like me, so extra small. It was great. I couldn't wait to put it on. And so got it home, and I looked at it. It looked so fabulous, Black Lives Matter, and I knew I was going to be part of the movement. And so I said, I got to figure out where I'm going to wear it. And I was giving a talk in New York City at a law school, and I said, I'm going to wear my Black Lives Matter in New York City. That's so great. New York City is a big city with lots of people. And so after my talk, where I wore my bow tie and all that kind of stuff, I went back to my hotel and changed to my Black Lives Matter t-shirt. And I went outside. I had my shades on. I mean, I gotta just show you exactly how this went down, because it was so real. I had my shirt on. I was so excited because I had my Black Lives Matter. Because to me, this t-shirt was great. And so I had my shades on and I had my shirt and I was walking down. You know, when you know you look good, I mean, it's a day where you showered good. The shower gel just sat on you right. You smell good. You just feel good about yourself. You know, you just, when you walk, there's just like an extra hip. Maybe you just feel like an extra one. You don't even, there's nothing there. It's just you got to put more into it. So I'm walking down the street in my Black Lives Matter shirt. And before you know it, I started spotting people who would look at my shirt and then look at me, and smiles went flat. I saw people who would watch me, you know, walking, because I was feeling good. I was smelling good. I had like the best cologne on ever. And so I was feeling good. They're like, oh my God, look at him. He looks so cool. And they look down at my shirt and be like, before you know it, I also started noticing people who would look at my shirt and roll their eyes, look at my shirt and avoid my path. Before you know it, I didn't feel safe in my Black Lives Matter t-shirt. I got a lot of shirts, but there's only one shirt that I own that when I put it on, I no longer feel safe in all settings. And why is it that I can wear this shirt and I can wear any other shirt, but when I wear a shirt that says my life and Black Lives Matter, I'm immediately transformed into a target. Target of hate, a target for injury, target for racism. So I'm walking down the street and my pace has slowed. I'm still trying to feel good. I can catch a hint of my cologne every now and again. It gives me what I need. But before you know it, I'm like, I'm gonna go back to the hotel and change shirts. This don't feel good. And just as I got to, anybody ever been to New York City? Just as I got, so I'm in Times Square. Just as I got to the corner of 7th and 38th, never will forget it. I was about to turn back around, go back to my hotel and change outfits. Got to this corner of 7th and 38th. This very tall white gentleman was on the corner. He looked at my shirt. He looked at me. He looked at my shirt. He looked at me, and then he started walking toward me. And I knew then that everything that I had seen on the news was about to happen to me. That my life does matter, but as this white gentleman, I'm sitting there, I'm looking at him. I'm about to turn around, but he's got the face of like, why are you here? And I'm gonna help you get back to that hotel real quick. And now I can run real fast. I've been running track since high school. So I'm like, I'm about to put it on, but then I'm looking at him and he just starts darting toward me. I mean, moving people out of the way. He's super tall too, he can move. I can't really do that, the fun size, but he's moving people out of the way to get to me. And before you know it, I'm sitting here thinking, oh my gosh, I'm about to go down. I'm about to be killed. Ah! And just before I scream and take off running, the guy reaches out to me and he says, hey, can I hug you? I said, what? He said, I just wanna hug you because your life does matter. And at the corner of 7th and 38, this very tall white man hugged me. And he taught me something, that everybody who reaches out to you is not trying to hurt you. Sometimes people reach out because they're trying to help you. Sometimes they're reaching out because they want to hug you. That everybody who's white is not anti-Black Lives Matter. There are some black people who are anti-Black Lives Matter. But our lives matter. Black lives matter, our history matters, and so too do the lives of every single person who's been lost in this movement. Trayvon Martin's life matters. Michael Brown's life mattered. Eric Garner's life mattered. Freddie Gray's life mattered. Laquan McDonald's life mattered. John Crawford III's lives matter. Tamir Rice, I could keep going. We gotta say their name because their lives matter. And we have to remember that past as we start to shape direction for our future. Black lives still matter, our history matter, and my research shows me that what most people are looking for is most people want to belong. In fact, I had a really interesting anecdote yesterday. My mom called me on the phone. My mom, I love my mom. She's my number one fan. My dad's my number one fan. My grandmother, although she's deceased now, is also my number one fan. They used to tell me that all my time. My mom called me yesterday. She said, you know what, son? Have you ever had your mom do this? She said, you know what, son? First of all, when she calls me son, I know she's about to lecture. She's like, you know what, son? I love your thesis. I said, my thesis? She said, yeah, belonging matters. Sense of belonging. It's like, that's kind of cool. My mom just said sense of belonging, right? She said, because I think everybody wants to belong. Before you know it, she started talking about what's happening. And if you're not politically engaged, I encourage you to use Black History Month as a time to stay politically engaged, get politically engaged, wake up and stay woke. Because there's so much happening in the world around. The proposition to build a wall that separates us from them is all about belonging. It's trying to tell us who belongs here in this United States. And it's awfully funny to me how anybody in the United States can start to make decisions about who belongs here when none of us belong here. We're all from somewhere else. If you don't know that part of your history, you ought to use Black History Month to find out where am I from. And I'm not talking about from Mobile, Alabama. You're not from Mobile, Alabama. Your family might have been born there. You may be from that area, but find out beyond there. Where'd you come from? And how do we get here? And it connects to my earlier question of exactly then, why are we here? Everybody wants to belong. Everybody wants to feel like they matter. And what my research has shown me is that belonging is the sense, the shared faith that my needs will be met by our commitment to being together. Everybody has needs. By a show of hands, how many of you in here have ever heard of Maslow's hierarchy of needs? Psychology majors, any psychology majors? Psychology majors, good, I see psych majors. All right, psych majors, back me up here. This can be psych 101 kind of stuff in like 3 seconds. So Maslow, Abraham Maslow says, as humans, all of us have basic human needs. By a show of hands, how many of you in here want no friends ever in life? Yeah, no one ever raised, that's not true. I've had 3 people in the country raise their hand, and what I think they should do is get together and not be friends. But most people want friends. Most people want to be connected to people who share their interests, share something about them. And Abraham Maslow says, we all have basic human needs like air, water, food, shelter, sleep, and sex. I didn't say it, Abraham said it. So if you don't have some, you should get some because Abraham said you need some. Just saying, it's Black History Month, keep it real, right? Once these basic physiological needs are in place, higher order needs like air and security and safety emerge. Safety and security are really, really important. It's hard to pass a test in a classroom where you don't feel safe. It's hard to thrive in a classroom where you don't feel secure. And it's not just physical safety and security, although higher education has learned a lot about physical safety and security over the past couple years, but it's also about our emotional safety and security. When we're not in classrooms where we know the appropriate language is going to be used, where professors don't teach us with strengths-based approaches, that's simply to say that they teach us like we can all achieve. They don't talk to us as if we're operating at a deficit. We're not academically ready to be here. So how do we create environments where everyone's set up to succeed? It's when we have safety and security in place, and then love and belongingness emerge. What I like to say is the only thing that stands between our basic operations and fulfillment of our mission is love and belongingness. And for the students in the audience, the only thing that stands right in the middle of where you begin, and for a whole lot of people was this morning with sleep, and your highest potential is love and belongingness. Love and belongingness is critically important. It's part of our history to understand that we matter and that we belong here. We belong here at Alabama A&M. We belong here in the country, and that our history gives us everything we need to know. That Black History Month didn't start as a month, started as a week. So when people say, you know, do we still need the month? No, we need the year. But until we can get the year, and that is that it's celebrated year round and it's infused in the curriculum, and that I get to learn about my own history just as much as I get to learn about other people's history, we can at least dedicate a month aside to concentrated effort to celebrate the contributions and achievements of African American and Pan-African people in this country. We have to have Black History Month because for many people, it's without February, we would never hear about anybody other than Dr. Martin Luther King, who's an important person to know. But there's so many others who we never hear about until February. That's why we have Black History Month. Carter G. Woodson, the Miseducation of the Negro. If you've never read that book, you have to read it. Because if nothing more, we gotta fight miseducation. Miseducation happens all over the place. I remember when a teacher told me I was low income. And I said, really? Oh, thank you, okay. So I started walking around in fourth grade and I said, oh, well, I'm low income. So whenever they would talk about free and reduced lunch, I raised my hand. I'm eligible for free and reduced lunch because my teacher said I'm low income. When I went into class and they said, now all the low income kids, I raised my hand because I never asked anybody, what does low income mean? But a teacher told me I was low income. And then one day, I started studying in college, social class. And the professor told me that a marker of being middle income, above lower income, are things like, did you, at this time, have a full set of encyclopedias in your home? And I remember Encyclopedia Britannica being in the hallway on the way to my bedroom growing up. I said, check. Now, Did you have a computer in the home? Yeah, I had a computer. I remember typing my homework assignments on the computer downstairs. Started as a Tandy, became an IBM. Ultimately, we moved up to Apple. Check, I have a computer. Then it said you were above low income, maybe middle income, if you remember having planned family vacations. Now, I did not travel outside the country as a young person growing up, but I do remember growing up in Virginia Beach, Virginia. Every now and again, we would go to Richmond, Virginia, to King's Dominion Amusement Park. Every now and again, we would take a trip to D.C. to see the museums and the monuments. I said, check. Now, wait a minute. How in the world am I in college reading about social class and now picking up indicators or measures that somehow I'm not low income, I might even be middle income or middle low income, but it was a teacher in fourth grade who, without giving me any inventory at all, assigned me to be low income. You gotta know who you are, and you gotta know your own history. Not here at Alabama A&M, but some professors teach you whatever they wanna teach you. Not the history, not the fact, but alternative facts. Alternative facts. And you've got to be so grounded in your own understanding of who you are in your own history that you can spot an alternative fact and say, no, I don't know that. I'm not from that history. I remember being a music major at the University of Virginia, and I talked about the contributions of African musicians and how so much music in the United States traces its roots back to the vibes and the timbre and the tempo and the sounds and the cadence of African beats. And it was a white gentleman in my class. It's not always white people. I'm gonna come to that in a minute. It's not always white people who say these things, but it was a white gentleman in my class who turned to me and said, well, if you think African music is so great, why don't you go back? I looked at my professor, hoping that they would save me from, well, actually save him from what was about to happen. But my professor said, do you have a response? And I did have a response. I said to the guy, I'm the fun side, so when I stand up, you can't really tell I'm standing up. So I asked the professor, I said, may I? She said, yes. I came to the front of the classroom. And I said to my colleague, I said, you know what, actually, it's a great recommendation. I would love to go to Africa. Which part of Africa are you talking about? He said, well, I'm talking about the whole state. It's not a state. I didn't mean state, I meant the whole country. It's not a country. It's full of multiple countries. Now, if you had listened to my presentation, what I was talking about are the beats and the timbre and the sounds of Eastern African cultures. And Eastern Africa is so different from what, but if you want to go to, I want to go to all of Africa. But in fact, I've never been to Africa. I'm African American, means I was born in America. The same place where you were born, I was born. I think we can take a field trip, Professor, to Africa to learn about our music. In fact, I think that the history of music is incomplete until musicians go to Africa to learn about the contributions of African people. I think what you've actually, you have helped me tremendously. You've helped the professor tremendously because we're paying all this money for an education. You're going to get a degree in music and you're going to be absent any understanding of the contributions of Africans to your understanding of music. And you're going to sit there and think when you play blues that you created it. That when you play jazz, somehow you created jazz. But in fact, there's a connection between what Duke Ellington's talking about. Billy Strayhorn is one of my relatives. Billy Strayhorn wrote A-Train for Duke Ellington. When Duke Ellington's talking in his music, it traces its way all the way back to what Mr. Moore was talking about. There's a connection between gospel and jazz and blues. And we struggle to understand it because we're not given complete education, we're given miseducation. Miseducation isn't just a phrase, it's missing education. What's missing from your education? How will you feel what's missing from your education? My grandmother taught me one of the most important things to do is figure out what you're missing and figure out how to then fill the gap with what you're missing. See people taking some pictures of these things. These are just the seven elements of belonging. The one I want to call to your attention, number four, is that Black lives matter, we matter, that belonging relates to mattering. And mattering has four components to it. The one I want to talk about is ego extension. It's over in the corner. Ego extension is the experience of experiencing yourself in another person. How many of you in here are willing to raise your hand and say that you are in a relationship right now? In a relationship right now. Keep your hands up if your relationship is good and you like it. Put your hands down if you don't. It's okay, unless they're with you. Keep it up, keep it up, keep it up. Just look this way and keep it up, right? Right? So you're in a relationship. If you're in a good relationship, I would argue that you experience ego extension. Ego extension is the experience of self in another person. It's my good days become your good days. My bad days become your bad days. It's that when I come home from class and say, oh, I failed the quiz. They say, you failed the quiz. I'm so sorry to hear about that. What can I do to make your day better? Ego extension. It's that when you lose, it's that when you are sitting there in the evening and you say, I don't want to talk about something, they don't say, why you don't ever want to talk? I'm going to find somebody who wants to talk to me. But in fact, they say, you know what? I know I talk a lot. And I understand you had a full day. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to give you your space and your time. I'm going to go over here and just talk to the puppy. And then when you're ready, call me back over. I got something to tell you. Because you understand each other. You strive to, everybody wants to feel like people understand them. People give them their space. That people empathize with their feelings. I think there's a lot in that that the White House could learn. Nobody wants to hear about a wall that's going to divide people. Nobody wants to hear about who doesn't belong and who doesn't fit and what doesn't. People all want to hear, they want to see nods when they start talking about what they've overcome. People always want people to affirm their struggles. It doesn't mean that your struggles are my struggles, but we can agree that we both have had struggles and that because of our struggles, we are better. Everybody yearns for that experience. Learning from our past, projecting to our future, belonging really matters. And this is what I think connects me to my final couple points here. First of all, I was in fourth grade. I used to date a girl named Becky. Becky had good hair, by the way. But being born and raised in Virginia Beach, Virginia, my pickings for African American young women were slim. And so I found a suitable alternative in fourth grade named Becky. I remember when I first started liking Becky, Becky was the fun size too. And you know, I would go outside and I would like throw rocks at Becky or whatever you do to show girls that you like them, right? And so before you know it, I pop the question, hey Becky. So clearly you know, like I like you, you like me. She's like, I like you. I'm like, yeah. So I was just wondering if we could date. And Becky was like, no, because I don't like you. Growing up in Virginia Beach, Virginia, I had learned as an early age, my mom told me at like 5 or 6, she said, Terrell, you're a black man living in a white man's world. I don't know what that meant. I was only 5, but I mean, she told me it. And then she said, because of this, you're gonna have to work twice as hard and you'll always get half as much. But I've always been good at math. So at first it really frustrated me that I had to work twice as hard and get half as much. But as I started getting no bigger, but older, I realized, well, what happens if I work 8 times as hard and sustain myself with the resources I need to preserve my youth, to preserve my health? What could I start to realize if I were not afraid to work hard? Never be afraid to do good work. Never be afraid to work hard. Because as I'm sitting there, I knew that race mattered. So I turned to Becky. I said, you don't like me because I'm black? She said, no, I don't like you because you don't wear glasses. I said, oh, I just need glasses? So I went home that day and I told my mom and dad. I said, hey, mom, dad, where are you? I need glasses. So they took me to the eye doctor, and you've ever gone to do an eye exam, this is what it looked like. True story, fourth grade, Mr. McCarthy was my teacher, and without glasses, as the doctor said, read that top line. I said, which one? The one that starts with the Z? I can't see it. Now, if I just read the Z, clearly I could see it, right? But before you know it, I was like, oh, that top line says Z, P, E, D. He was like, all right, now read the very bottom line. I'm like, which one that starts with the D? There's no way I can see that. Before you know it, I had given the doctor everything he needed to know that let him know that I was either faking my eye exam or I wanted glasses. Interestingly enough, doctors have power. Before you know it, the doctor made a decision. I wanted glasses or I was faking. The doctor decides to write me a prescription for a very light corrective lens, because he has the power to do it. Sometimes you gotta know what you're gonna do with the power that's in your hand. And the doctor wrote me a prescription for corrective lenses. I remember I was like a negative 0.5. But as a result of that, I mean, it's basically like nothing. It's like having a napkin, a clear napkin up to your face, right? So here I am with glasses. I went back to school. I said, hey, Becky. And she was like, oh my God, you got glasses. I'm like, yeah, so by the way, can we date now? And we started dating. And that was just that magical. But interestingly enough, I learned something about this. I now wear a negative 8. I have a restriction on my license that says I cannot drive without corrective lenses. I have an acute astigmatism that's so strong that I can't do LASIK without harm to the eye. And what's the point of this? It's simply to say that as I've talked to doctors, they said, you know what, that doctor should have never given you that corrective lens when you were in fourth grade, because once you have a crutch or once you have a support that you actually don't need, you weaken the strength of your muscles. You weaken the strength when you start depending on stuff that you don't need. You weaken yourself when you depend on stuff that you don't need. I don't know who I'm talking to, but it's somebody in this room who needs to check those friends, because some friends you don't need beside you. During Black History Month, it's a good time to start cleaning through, going through your mental Rolodex and say, you know what, I heard a speaker and he told me I don't need you, because the more I depend on you, the weaker I get. I'm determined I'm gonna be strong. As a result of that, I gave up my vision for Becky. And Becky broke up with me in the sixth grade. So sometimes you make sacrifices for people who never will make the same sacrifices for you. Never make a permanent decision for somebody who's temporarily in your life. Black History Month, Black History Month. Learn from our past and prepare for the future. Never make somebody a priority when all you are is an option. If you're just an option for them, let them be an option. Stop making people priorities. Every time they call, you pick up. You asleep at night and you pick up. Oh my gosh, it's them. Oh my goodness, it's them. And then when you call, it goes to voicemail. Wake up. Wake up and stay woke. Black History Month is learning from our past and understanding that we're preparing ourselves for our future. And remember this, that you are responsible for what you see. Everybody can't see what you see. Somebody here today can walk across this campus and say, you know what, I'm just going to keep it real because I only got a few more minutes anyway, and I feel my help coming on anyhow. So somebody can walk across this campus and somebody can say, you know what, President, we should replace those plants back there. I think there's some better plants back there. And you're sitting there saying, I hope the president and the first lady will replace those plants. I hope Dr. Gilmore will replace those plants. They're not looking at those plants. They can't even see the plants. You can see the plants. And so because you can see it, you're responsible for it now. Now you got to figure out, now that you see it, just like the Uber dreamer, now that you see a way to improve the campus, to open up the campus, to make the campus more hospitable and welcoming to people like yourself, people who are not from Alabama, people who are first generation, to gay lesbian students, so you can see how to open up the campus and make it more hospitable and more welcoming. Now you're responsible for it. Sit down with some friends and figure out what's the strategy, what's the plan, what's the day, what's the time, what's the event. Stop waiting for somebody else to always do it. We come from a group of people who never waited. In fact, we would not be here if our ancestors waited for people to do it. We come from a group of people who had initiative, who had drive, who were never afraid about effort or about hard work. You're responsible for what you see, and the purpose of your being here is to find your why. Why in the world are you here? Why are we here together? It's also to figure out and find out what's your lane. People tell me all the time. I was just yesterday speaking at a campus, and during the Q&A, some students asked a question. They said, well, why don't you become a comedian? You're really funny. I get this question a lot, really. And my answer to the question, in case you want to ask it later, is this: because I'm a professor. And the professor is not a comedian. You can have funny professors. I'm a funny professor. I'm probably even a funny-looking professor sometimes, but I will never be a comedian. I tried it once. I went to the Funny Bonus, a comedy club in Columbus, Ohio, and I told the developer, I said, hey, put me on your show. I got people tell me I'm really funny. And she said, okay, you got 5 minutes. And I got up there, and I got them to laughing. But in order to really take a crowd to that next level, you've got to have a potty mouth. And I don't have a potty mouth. I can't be a professor and a preacher and a son and a father, all the things that I am, and then push it there. So the moment I start trying to be a comedian, I'm moving going outside my lane. Now I'm all over here in the weigh-in brothers' lanes. First of all, that's trespassing. Get back in your own lane. My lane is to be a professor. You will get killed moving into other people's lanes. That is illegal just to jump over in somebody else's lane. No turn signal or nothing. You're not going to tell me you coming for me? Why are you coming for me? Stay over in your lane. If you're going to be a hairdresser, be a hairdresser. If you're gonna be a musician, be a musician. If you're gonna be a doctor, if you're gonna be a lawyer, if you're gonna be an engineer, stay in your lane. The world will push you and say, you know what, you don't gotta be an engineer because your hair is fabulous. You should be a hairstylist. You tell them, you know what, I'm gonna be an engineer with good hair, with great hair, good looking hair, but I'm not going to be a hairstylist. The world doesn't get to define who you are, but they'll try. So you gotta use the past to figure out, how do I set a course for my future and stay in my lane? And last and finally, how do I stay true to myself? My past has always been different. Some people this morning were asking me, how old am I? So I'm not old. But I'm gonna tell you something. I have a daughter who's now 20. And you can do the math, it's public information. You get down to some real small digits when you start figuring out when she was born. It's a safe space, and it's Black History Month, so don't judge, okay? I done been through too many black churches that wanted to judge me about having a kid in my teens. I'm not coming to Alabama A&M to deal with a whole bunch of people who want to resurrect me and crucify me. I had her when I was a teen. I had her when I was a baby. It's not like I was 14 years old and said, you know what I'm gonna do? I done finished my cereal. I'm gonna go make me a baby. I think that's what I'm gonna do today. That's not how it happened. It happened. That's what happened. Usually that's what happens. It happened. It's complicated. And it happened. But as a result of it, she was there. And just when I thought I was going to have to give up on college, I was like, oh my gosh, I'm not going to be able to go to college. I got this baby. My mom and dad, so you're taking that baby to college with you. So I went to the University of Virginia with my baby. And literally, this past Christmas was really remarkable because that's when she turned 20 in November. And so the 20-year-old is sitting in my living room. She points to this picture on the wall. She says, Dad, did I ever tell you this is my favorite picture of me? I said, that's so funny. That's my favorite picture of you. I said, do you know where you are in that picture? She said, well, based on the background, I would say like an amusement park. I said, yeah, right. You're in my dorm room at UVA when I was an undergrad. She said, what am I doing in your dorm room? I said, you lived in the dorm. Well, actually, you didn't live in the dorm room. You lived in my book bag because when I went to class, oh, come on, nobody's ever been in a situation where you don't know what to do and who's gonna judge. Nobody wanted to help you, people just wanted to judge you. So you do the best you can with what you've got. That's what my family taught me. So I knew I had to go to class. My mom and dad said, you're taking her with you. So I went to biology, put her in the book. I didn't zip it up. I mean, I put her in the book bag so I could see her, and I'm taking my notes, and she was fine, and you know, taking my notes and trying to stay really secret about this. And only when she cried and people were like, whose book bag is crying? Did I grab my book bag and leave? And now I sat there in the living room this Christmas and the 20-year-old is looking at this picture. And I remember being a freshman at UVA thinking, I'm so scared. What if they find out I have a baby? I'm so scared. What if they kick me out? What happens if I don't get to finish college? I had so many dreams for my life. I wanted to be this and I wanted to be that. And as a result of this one complicated mistake, not my daughter, but the act, I'm sitting here now and my whole future is gone. And I'm sitting in my living room and the 20-year-old is looking at the picture. And I realized that the God that I serve turned all that stuff around. Black History Month. But before I know it, that which I used to fear, I now find strength in it. That my daughter is healthy. That the book bag didn't hurt her. Oh my gosh, I broke down into tears. I didn't cry at ET, but I cried that day. Because I realized that there's so much more within us than we will ever give ourselves credit for. If you ever believe in yourself, and start to believe in the possible selves, who you could become. There is no telling how far you'll go. One day I was going to a really important meeting, and they said to me, Terrell, we want you on this really important university committee. So I said, I gotta go. I gotta figure out what to wear. And I was putting it all together, and that day I just decided to be a part of the choir. I was gonna wear all black. Black shirt, black blazer, black slacks. I probably had on funky socks, but excuse those. And then I had to figure out what shoes. I was gonna do like black shoes, like y'all's shoes, the dress shoes. But then something told me, no, you really like Converse. And I was like, yeah, that's what I've been wearing. But now that I'm in this like, you know, senior level position, I had moved on a little up the ladder a bit. I was like, now that I've moved up a bit, I can forget those Converse. I can put my dress shoes on, but I really wanted to wear my Converse. And I said, well, I'm gonna go ahead and put my Converse on. No, I'll put the dress shoes on. No, they're gonna judge me in the Converse. They're gonna Before you know it, I just was 5 minutes late to the meeting trying to fool with these shoes. I put on the Converse. I go to the meeting. Because I'm late, there's only one seat open. I get ready to sit down in this seat, and I notice that the woman beside me has this really fabulous designer bag. I'm so distracted by the bag. It's full of colors. It looks really great. I want it in my life. I'm about to sit down with my Converse on, but I'm so distracted by her bag. And then the meeting unfolded. We were looking for a chancellor for the University of Tennessee, Knoxville. This meeting was over. I had sufficiently done my job. I got ready to leave, and the woman with the nice bag calls out to me and says, hey, you. I turn around. She's a white female. Turn around. She says, you. I said, yes, ma'am. She said, where are you going? I said, back to my office. She said, don't move. I want to talk to you. She comes over. She says, walk with me. We start walking out. She says, I really liked what you did in that meeting. It takes someone sometimes to speak up for people who can't speak for themselves. She knew all the right words. But I thought to myself, well, then why didn't you do it? But that's fine, that's fine, that's fine. Sometimes you're responsible for what you see. Everybody can't see what you see. So sometimes you're in the meeting, you're called to speak up because you're the person who can see it. You're the person who's in that meeting. That's your assignment in that meeting. So I said to her, thank you very much. She said, and by the way, I have a really important question for you. What are those things on your feet? And I said, oh, they're Converse. Do you not know what Converse? She said, I never heard of those. Who are you who's never heard of Converse? She says, walk with me. We're walking out the building, and she presses the fob on her key, and I hear, doo-doo. Who are you who's pressing the fob inside the building? I can still hear it. Like, where's your car? There's no parking lot near this building. So, and I go outside the door, and she's in a gold ML350 Mercedes-Benz sitting right there on the sidewalk. Who are you who gets to sit and park their car on the sidewalk? I know she's not the president. She's not the president's wife because I know all them people. Who is this lady who has the kind of power that she gets to sit on the sidewalk? I mean, park. She can probably sit on the sidewalk too. She can park on the sidewalk. Before you know it, she says, by the way, where did you get your Converse? I said, I got my Converse from Journeys. She said, where's Journeys? I said, it's in the mall. She said, well, do you think they have any more? And I said, I think they have a lot, actually. She said, good. Okay, get in the car and take me. And so before you know, I'm in the car and I'm, why am I in her car and I don't know her? My mother taught me, you don't speak to strangers. You certainly don't get in their car. But sometimes the current of life will carry you to a place that you are not ready for. You got to follow what you feel. You got to be wise. Listen to your past. Pay attention to your sensories. But sometimes the current of life will just move you. You can feel it. You know you're supposed to take that step. You know you're supposed to take that job. You know you're supposed to take that course. You know you're supposed to accept that internship. Just go with the currents of life because sometimes the currents of life are designed to carry you to your future. So I'm sitting here in her car not knowing why, but I'm there. I'm like, turn. Left and now right and go down 40. Before you know it, we go to Journeys and I meet my friend Chris with a K. I say, hey, Chris, this is me. I say, this is my friend D. D wants a pair of Converse. Chris sold me, I don't know, dozens of pairs of Converse. So I said, Chris, help D find a pair of Converse. D gets her Converse. She gets a pink pair. She goes up to pay. They rang them up. It was like $39. She said, oh my gosh, they're so inexpensive. They're so cheap. She said, wait, Terrell, you didn't get a pair. I said, no, I already got like 100 pair. No, I'm gonna take 101 though. So sometimes the current of life will put you around people who can bless you. Never turn down their blessings because sometimes, yes. Yeah, it's part of your future. So before you know it, I accept my 101 pair of Converse and my friend D buys them. I go back to campus. Before you know it, I say to my friends, I met this woman. She had a great bag. They said, what is her name? I said, D. I don't know what her last name was. They said, D. Haslam. I said, D. Haslam. That does sound like her name. I said, wait, you know her? They said, Terrell, everybody knows her. I said, why? They said, Terrell, what's the name of the College of Business at the University of Tennessee? I said, it's called the Haslam College of Business. They said, what's the name of the full ride scholarship at the University of Tennessee? I said, it's called a Haslam scholarship. They said, what's the name? And they kept walking me. What's the name of the build? I said, you mean to tell me that D Haslam is that Haslam? They said, yeah, she's married to Jimmy Haslam, who is the CEO of all Pilot gas stations in the country. Wow. But what they didn't tell me is that D. Haslam, how many of you in here watch HGTV, Love It or List It, any of those kind of things, do this for me on behalf of Black History Month. Next time you watch the show, let the credits roll. At the very end of it, you're going to see something that says powered by Scripps Media. Go to online, Google Scripps Media. The CEO of Scripps Media is D. Haslam, whose grandfather and father created and invented cable television. Now, I was about to leave Tennessee. The president of Tennessee said, hey, we don't want you to leave. So I decided that year I wasn't going to leave. And they said, we want to give you something. I said, what does he want to give me? They said a research center. They gave me a research center called the Center for Higher Education Research and Policy. And then I told my friend Dee, I said, hey, Dee, I got this new cool research center. Now I just got to raise funds for it. She started picking up that she had money. So I was like, I need money. And she said, well, I want to throw you a party. In my head, I said, I don't want a party. I want some money. But what I didn't know is that the currents of life will always push you in the direction you need to go. You just got to be in tune with yourself and where you're going enough to know how to get there. So before you know it, my friend Dee said to me one day, she said, I'm going to throw you a party. And Terrell, by the way, who's your favorite singer? I said, well, I don't know because, I mean, gospel is my favorite form of music. My grandmother was my first music teacher. My mom's mom. I remember being 6 years old in my grandmother's kitchen when she taught me my first gospel song. She said, hey, baby, while flipping pancakes and making bacon and all this stuff, and she said, Rail, now listen, that's what my grandmother taught me. She would say, now the words of the song, honey, are this little light of mine. I'm going to let it shine. And then she would go through all the words. And then she would sing it for me. And my grandmother had a very beautiful, full voice. She would have been a great member of your choir. And then she would say, now, baby, you sing. And I was 6 years old. I was like, Ma, I don't sing. And she said, sing. I said, Ma, I don't really want to sing. She said, baby, sing for mother. And I said, this little light of mine, I'm going to let it shine. Whoa. Right. My grandmother said, you sound terrible. But if you practice and work at it, one day you'll connect with the voice. I can see a voice in you that you can't see. And if you ever practice and work with it long enough, you'll connect with it. One day she called me up in her church and said, Rail, I want you to come up here and sing This Light of Mine. It had been years since I had thought about that song. And I stood up in front of all 57 people, so scared. And out of nowhere said, this little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. This little light of mine, I'm going to let it shine. This little light of mine, yeah, I'm going to let it shine. Let it shine, let it shine, let it shine. She taught me those kind of things. I remember when she was about to die in her hospital bed, she had taught me this song that you need to know. It's Black History Month. You have a past that's going to prepare you for your future. My grandmother, before she died, when I was like 8 years old, she said, Burrell, this is my favorite song. The words of the song are, there's a bright side somewhere. There's a bright side somewhere. Don't you give up until you find it. There's a bright side somewhere. And I say, Ma, how does it go? And she started singing it, and then she gave me the opportunity to sing it. We traveled all through North Carolina singing that song sometimes. We would go to St. Philip's Church, and the pastor would say, Miss Warner and her grandson's here. Come up and sing this song. But it was November 19th, 2013. I was in Craven County Community Hospital. My grandmother had suffered an aneurysm. I'm in there taking care of her. She doesn't know the day of the week. She doesn't know my mom's name. She doesn't know Obama's name. She knows nothing. She's just in the bed, and at 11:30, the nurse came in and said, are you staying the night? I said, yeah, I'm gonna stay the night. I just want to hold my grandmother's hand. She hadn't talked in weeks. We drifted off to sleep while I sat in that chair. And then at about 1:17 a.m., I was awakened. My grandmother's hand started shaking. I said, Ma, are you okay? She wasn't saying anything. I reached for the button to call the nurse. And though she had not talked in weeks, at 1:17 a.m., November 19, 2013, impressed on my mind forever, in the stillness of the night, my grandmother said, hey, Rail. I said, Ma, you're speaking. I'm trying to get the nurse to hurry up and come so she can witness all this. And my grandmother said, now don't forget, baby, there's a bright side somewhere. There's a bright side somewhere. Don't you give up until you find there's a bright side somewhere. It had been years since I heard my grandmother sing that song, but at 1:17 a.m., she sang it. I sang it with her, and like that, she was gone. For years, I've traveled places and told people that story. And just last year, I realized I have not been back to my grandmother's house since she died. And I told my mom, I said, I'm going to go back and see my grandmother. She said, well, you know she's not there. I said, she's always going to be there. And I went to Trenton, North Carolina, and I found the graveyard where we buried her. I walked up to her grave and I said, hey, I miss you. There are days I wish you were still here. I travel the country and I tell people about you and all the stuff you taught me, and people love you. You would be a great speaker. And I tell them about that time. I don't know why you sing that song, but I sing it and I tell them about it. And I keep telling them that there's a bright side somewhere. That even on the darkest day, no matter who's in the White House or what's happening in the country, that there's a bright side somewhere. And I was sitting there talking to my grandmother in the graveyard. I'm sure people who looked probably thought I had lost my mind. And though, President, I arrived in the graveyard at night after I talked to my grandmother. I said, and so because you sang that song the last time, I'm going to sing it again. But you remember when I was 6 years old, you taught me this song that there's a light, there's a bright side somewhere. And you talked about the light. Well, I don't know if you know this, Grandma, but the word education in the Greek is to bring out the light that is within. And so somehow you teaching me at 6 years old about light led me to follow in your footsteps into education. And I want you to know that there's a light. There's a light in you. There's a light in me. There's a light in the world. This little light of mine, I'm gonna go everywhere and let it shine. And I sang it. And as I opened my eyes after talking to my grandmother, I realized it was bright out. And I thought, had I been here this long that daytime had come? And I looked up, but in fact, it wasn't daytime. The moon had just shifted and shone a light right on my grandma's grave. And I left knowing that she heard me and that there's still a light. When Dee asked me, who's my favorite singer? I said, well, apart from gospel, my favorite singer is John Legend. Why? She said, because I want John Legend to be at your party. So that's not even funny. Why would you joke about that? She said, what would you want John to sing about? I told her, I said, I would want John to help me carry my message about light. John's out of the church, so John had a piano one time at a church. I heard him sing, This a Light of Mine. So Dee decided she would work her magic and as a result bring John Legend to that event. And John and I got to sing This a Light of Mine. Now, is the point about John Legend, is the point about This a Light of Mine, is about all of it actually, but the takeaway message is don't ever be afraid to wear your Converse if you want to wear them. Thank you.
tell the story of our glory.
Like this, I have been certainly challenged. I have been motivated. I have been inspired. And I'm certain that all of you here will say the same. Dr. Gilmore indicated to me that she had the opportunity of hearing a very dynamic young man at a conference, and she was just all excited about having him come to Alabama A&M University. But you know, we hear that all the time. People go and they hear persons and they are excited. But I can tell you that you didn't do justice, Dr. Gilmore, in saying the kind of dynamic, multi-talented person who gave all of us a message quite appropriate as we begin this Black History Month celebration. So I want us all to stand and give him a bulldog ovation. Thank you so very, very much for coming, and I assure you, and I can say this as president of the university, that we will have you come back. We will have you come back many, many more times because this is a message that needs to be shared over and over again. So we're going to have you here so often that sometimes the Ohio State University will ask the question, are you still employed here or are you down at that place called Alabama Agricultural and Mechanical University? I'd like to present to you this certificate, presidential medallion, in recognition and tribute to your presentation as the keynote speaker for the Black History Month program at Alabama Agricultural and Mechanical University. Again, we want to thank you. I want to thank to all of the persons responsible for putting this program together, the committee. I certainly want to acknowledge the presence of members of our Board of Trustees. I have two trustees here. We have Trustee Dr. Jeanette Jones and Trustee Crawford. Thank you for your presence, as well as our deans, our faculty, our staff. But more particularly, I want to thank the very best students that exist anywhere in this nation, the students of Alabama Agricultural Mechanical University. Stand up and give yourselves a hand, please. I am certain, and as our speaker indicated, nothing is by accident. And we are all gathered in this place at this time because it was predestined for us to be here, to hear the message that we did hear. Now we've got to be sure that we take that message with us and that we use that message going forward, preparing us for our future. Thank you, choirs, for what you have done in contributing to this program. And let me just close with one verse that I think sums up much of what he said today. For I know the plans that I have for you, says the Lord. Plans not to harm you, but plans to prosper you and give you hope. God bless you. Thank you.